ජීවිතං කිච්ඡං සද්ධම්ම සවනං කිච්ඡෝ බුද්ධානං උප්පාදෝ කිච්ඡෝ මනුස්ස පටිලාබෝ birth as a human is a rare thing. Kichang machana jivitang. Living life as a human is also rare. It's a rare thing. Kichang saddhamma savanang. Listening to the real dhamma, sublime dhamma itself is rare. Kicho buddhanang uppado, birth of the Buddha, Buddhas is also rare. Friends, this is how the Buddha pointed out four rare things in the world. I am glad to be here with you this morning to share the Dhamma with you. Dhamma is the teaching of the Buddha, which is well expounded, which is excellent in the beginning, excellent in the middle, excellent in the end. This Dhamma is to be understood, to be practiced by all wise people. This Dhamma was taught for the wise. Today, for this Dhamma talk, the suggested topic is the uniqueness of the Buddha and his teachings. Friends, let's first understand the uniqueness of the Buddha. Buddha is a unique person. In the human history, for the last 91 eons, only 7 persons attained that supreme stage called Buddhahood. Only 7 persons. It's a rare being. Buddha is a rare being. It so happened that the Buddha was born on the full moon day of May, Vesak full moon day. He attained supreme enlightenment on the same day, the full moon day of May. And also he passed away on the same day, the full moon day of May, the Vesak day, though different years. These 3 events of his life took place on the same day. Isn't that itself is a wonder? A marvelous thing, a rare thing. According to the wonderful and marvelous things, the discourse named wonderful and marvelous things, Acharya Abhuta Dhamma Sutta of the Majjhima Nikaya, the middle length sayings of the Buddha, Buddha very clearly said that he was born mindfully. He lived his life mindfully. According to the Mahaparinibbana Sutta, the last days of the Buddha, it is again clear that Buddha passed away mindfully. That means the Buddha was born mindfully, he lived in this society mindfully, and he passed away mindfully. Such a great being. Such a great being. He was born in this society. He was born as a human. He developed his mind to the human perfection. Therefore, Buddha's birth is a happy thing. He himself said, happy is the birth of the Buddha, sukho buddhanang uppado. Happy is the birth of the Buddha, sukho buddhanang uppado. Sukha saddhamma desana, teaching the teaching of the true Dhamma, sublime Dhamma, is happy, is a cause for happy. Sukha saddhamma desana. Sukha sangasya samagi. Unity of the Sangha itself is a happy thing. Happy is the unity of the Sangha. Sukha sangasya samagi. Samagganang tapo sukho. The practice of the united Sangha itself is a happy thing. Happy is the unity of the Sangha. So this is how when the Buddhas are born to this world, it is a happy occasion. It is a happy thing. After the Buddha's birth, as he was a mindful prince, even while he was very young, he was contemplative, he was mindful, he was practicing Dhamma. Once he practiced under a rose apple tree, he practiced mindfulness of breathing and attained the first jhana. He, at the age of 29, as you all know, he renounced his worldly life. He went from his home life into the state of homelessness. King Kusala Gavesi, the people of the day, they went forth seeking what is truth, the difference between other people and the Buddha is this. Buddha went forth not to seek what is truth, but to seek what is kusala. King Kusala Gavesi. What is wholesome? That is what the Buddha wanted to see. That is what the Buddha wanted to seek. Seeking after what is kusala, he went forth. Eventually, he went to meet different teachers. He practiced different types of meditation. Finally, one day, he saw five dreams before his attainment of enlightenment. He saw five dreams. The first one, he was sleeping. That is the dream. He was sleeping on the floor, on earth. Earth, the whole earth is his bed. His head was the Himalayan range. It's Himalaya, the highest mountain in the world, Everest. That was the pillow of the Buddha. His left hand was in the eastern sea. His right hand was in the western sea. His feet in the southern sea. That was the dream. He saw this dream. Later on, the Buddha himself said the meaning of this dream. He dreamt this dream. He then explained, later on he explained the meaning. The meaning is that he will be the Buddha to the whole world, whole universe. That is the meaning of that dream. Secondly, he saw a particular grass which is called Itana in Sinhalese. In India it is called Thiriya. A particular grass came out of the rose up, out of his navel, a grass rose up to the sky, touched the sky, all the way to the sky, a grass. Later on he explained the meaning. That was the noble eightfold path, that he rediscovered and revealed would be the path for all humans and the deities, devas. That is the meaning. Third one, he saw worms, white worms with black heads. White worms with black heads. They all came to the Buddha and came up to the knees of the Buddha. They strolled up to the knees of the Buddha, the worms. Later on, the Buddha explained the meaning of this dream. That was white worms with black heads are the lay people. They come and respect the Buddha. That was the dream. Next one, the fourth one. Buddha saw four colors birds. They came from four colors, four birds from four directions. They came to the Buddha, and when they came and they fell there in front of the Buddha, at the feet of the Buddha, then they all became white. What is this? That is the different class of people, they come from different class and caste. You know, in the time of the Buddha, they have a different caste. The people talk about Brahmins, Kshatriya, Vaishya and Sudra. They were different caste in the time of the Buddha. They all came from different caste, different classes, and then they became one group of Sangha, disciples of the Buddha. That was the dream. Finally, he saw the fifth one. As Buddha was climbing to mountain of dung, where nothing soiled in his foot. He was climbing, but not soiled with the dungs, not soiled his feet with the dungs. Though the Buddha was given many types of requisites, whatever given to the Buddha as gift, Buddha is unattached, not clinging to these things. Those are the dreams. It's just before the attainment of enlightenment, Buddha dreamt these dreams. Buddha was not a god. He was neither a god nor an emissary, not a messenger. He was not a savior. He was a human being. He was born here in this society. He was born in India, according to the history, Buddhist history. We know very well where he was born. Even today when you go to India, you can see these places. So he was born as a human. He developed his mind and came to the state of human perfection. That is the difference. That is the wonder. That is marvelous thing that he did. That is the marvelous thing he did. So he became our Buddha on the full moon day of May, the Vesak full moon day. So friends, this is how we have to understand the uniqueness of the Buddha. He is a unique person, unique man, he who became a superman eventually. So let's now understand the Dhamma he realized on the day, during the night. He attained enlightenment, the full moon day of May. When it was evening, the Buddha came from the other side of the river, which is called Neranjara River. He crossed the river and came to this side, where he saw a shady tree, which is now known as the Bodhi tree. He sat under the tree and started to practice mindfulness of breathing. That is the meditation practiced by all Buddhas to attain enlightenment. He practiced mindfulness of breathing. While he was practicing mindfulness of breathing, during the first watch of night, he gained a knowledge. That knowledge is to understand his previous lives, how he was living in the previous lives. Many lives, hundred, thousand, millions, trillions, eons of lives, how he lived in the past. He understood that. That is called Pubbe Nivasa Nusati Jnana. That is the ability to recollect, remember his previous lives. During the second watch of the night, he realized he gained another knowledge, which is called Chutupapata Jnana. Chutu Uppatti means he got the ability to understand how beings are born to this world. They come from other realms, other planets, realms, other world. They come from other worlds and they are born here. Then those who are living here, they depart here and are born somewhere else. That is another knowledge he gained during the second watch of the night. When it was dawn, he got a special knowledge, which is again unique knowledge. That is called complete destruction of all taints. That is the ability to eradicate all taints. In Pali, asavakkhaya jnana. These three types of knowledge are called trividya. So he gained trividya, three types of knowledge. With that, the Buddha realized 37 factors of enlightenment. This is the real Dhamma. He realized, he rediscovered this Dhamma. He realized these 37 factors of enlightenment. What are the 37 factors of enlightenment? He realized the four establishments of mindfulness, the four right striving, the four roads to power, five spiritual faculties, five mental powers, seven factors of enlightenment, and the Noble Eightfold Path. These are the 37 factors which he rediscovered, realized, and later on revealed. These are the Dhamma, real Dhamma he realized. Buddha very clearly said this in the Mahaparinibbana Sutta. He said, monks, this Dhamma that I realized should be thoroughly learned by you, practiced, developed by you for the benefit of many, for the benefit, happiness for the multitudes. That's how the Buddha put this. Friends, this Dhamma, whole Dhamma, 37 factors of Dhamma could be condensed into three principles, three Dhamma, which I see as a triangle. The three Dhamma are the four noble truths, the dependent origination, and the three characteristics of existence. These are again unique. Nowhere else. Unique means nowhere else you can find this Dhamma. Nowhere else you find the four noble truth. Nowhere else you find the dependent origination. Nowhere else you find the three characteristics of existence. Therefore, Buddha himself said in the Chula Sihanada Sutra of the Majjhima Nikaya, the middle length saints, Buddha very clearly said, since there is no path, no four noble truths, no such Dhamma, the first Samana means the stream enterer, second Samana, the one Sritana, third Shramana, the non-returner, and the fourth Samana, the Arahant. Stray mentors, once returners, non-returners, and Arahant. Sotapanna, Sakadagami, Anagami, Arahant. These disciples, these students, can be seen only in this sasana, only in the dispensation of the Buddha. Because no noble eightfold path in other faith. Therefore it is again unique. So these three factors, three principles, the four noble truth, the dependent origination, and the three characteristics of existence are the main teachings, are the fundamental teachings. As I see, these three are the triangle. This is how the triangle is formed. These are the things that the Buddha rediscovered, realized, and revealed. With this, the Buddha discarded some teachings, some isms. By the time of the Buddha, there were 62 isms. 62 isms, cults. Buddha discarded them all. Buddha put them all into two categories, two baskets, eternalism and nihilism. Buddha could put them all into these two baskets and then discarded them all. That is why in the very first discourse of the Buddha, first thing that he said was, monks, De me bhikkhave anta pabbajitena na sevitabba. Monks, there are two extremes which are to be avoided by you. Why? To follow the middle way. Middle way is not going to extremes. If you go to the extremes, those are extremes. As long as you are in extremes, you cannot see the Dhamma. Therefore, the Buddha's instructions was to come to the middle way, middle path. That is nothing but the noble eightfold path. That is the path for all of us. That is the path for all of us. So in such a way, the Buddha taught this Dhamma. He gave up, abandoned 62 isms and two extremes. Once the Buddha delivered a discourse named the Lion, Miga Rajasutta, King of Beast. Buddha said, monks, addressing the monks, Buddha said, monks, the Miga Raja, the King of Beast, the Lion, when it is evening, the Lion comes out of his lair, his cave. He comes out when it is evening, and he then stretches himself and roars his lion's roar three times. When he roars his lion's roar, all beings, Buddha says, all beings that hear this sound, they all get fear, frightened, terror, sense of urgency. Sense of urgency. Because just listening to this sound. By then the Buddha said, those beings living in holes, they all go into the, they enter the holes because of fear. And all those beings live in woods, they enter the woods. Beings living in water, they enter the water because of fear. And the birds, they fly into the sky because of fear. Buddha says, so too, monks. With the birth of Tathagata, the Buddha, the beings like devas, who live long in different realms, thinking that they are eternal, they are permanent, thinking that they are eternally living there. When the Tathagata teaches the Dhamma based on the three characteristics of existence, impermanence, unsatisfactoriness, and the soullessness nature, when the Buddha teaches this Dhamma, they become fear, frightened, sense of urgency. Then they start to say, "Oh, sir, we thought that we are permanent, though we are impermanent. We thought that we are eternal, but it is otherwise. We are not eternal. It is because of the teaching of the Buddha. Only Buddhas teach us this type of Dhamma. The marvelous thing, the greatest thing in this sasana, this teaching of the Buddha, is that there is nothing to believe." Friends, this is how the Buddha gave us 100% freedom of thought. 100% given. Isn't that wonder? This is the real teaching. That is why we have to learn this Dhamma. That is why we have to follow this Dhamma. That is why we have to practice this Dhamma. Then we can live happily, peacefully, and one day we can realize this Dhamma here in this very world. We don't want to go anywhere else to realize this Dhamma. We don't want to go anywhere else to realize this Dhamma. It is at your home, in your same room. You can realize this Dhamma. This is the wonder. This is why I say that it is a unique teaching. Unique teaching. Nothing to believe. But we have to do our own exploration. We have to do our own examinations. Then we can understand this Dhamma. So in such a way the Buddha taught this Dhamma. Once the Buddha, in the time of the Buddha, there were three tenets, three doctrines. Some people believed that everything happens because of previous karma. Because of previous karma. Some people, they believed everything happens because of the Creator, as the Creator created. Third, another group, they thought that everything happens automatically, spontaneously, without any reason. How the people believe, this is how. So the Buddha said, "Monks, one day I went to meet these people." First the Buddha went to meet the first group, those who say everything happens because of previous karma. Buddha went to meet them and asked questions. Buddha said, I questioned them, interrogated. I asked them whether this killing, the first precepts, people kill beings. Buddha asked them whether this killing happens because of your previous karma. If it is previous karma, you cannot stop it. But some people, they stop it. As they can stop it, it is clear that it is not previous karma. Killing. And stealing, what about stealing? What about sexual misconduct? What about false speech? What about malicious talk? Harsh speech? Frivolous talk? Covetousness? Grief? Covetousness, ill will, wrong view, all these, you can stop this. So these are not because of previous lives, previous karma. That's how the Buddha questioned them. Then Buddha said, they became silent. Their argument became sort of inactive, inaction. Then The Buddha went to the second group. Buddha questioned them also. As they believed that everything happens because of Creator, Buddha put the same questions. Buddha asked whether this happened because of Creator. You kill these beings, if anybody is killing, is that because of Creator? If anybody is stealing, is that because of Creator? If anybody is practicing sexual misconduct, is that because of Creator? Like that, Buddha questioned them. Then they became silent, quite inactive, inaction. Then the third group, Buddha went visited them, asked them whether things happen because no reason, spontaneously. Then they also had to do the same thing. They all became silent. Thereafter, Buddha pointed out, Buddha said, this Dhamma that I teach is different. Buddha said, this Dhamma cannot be repeated, cannot be reproached. This Dhamma that I teach is uncensored by the wise. By the wise, this Dhamma cannot be reputed, refused. What are the Dhamma he taught? He said, in the whole world, everything is composed with six elements. What are the six? Earth element, water, fire, air, space and consciousness. These are the six elements through which all things, animate or inanimate, all things are composed with these six elements. Nobody can refute this. It's true. These are the elements. Six elements. Then the Buddha said, the man, we all have contact, six contact. It is because of these six contact, we are exposed to this world. Six type of contact, he taught. What are the contacts? Eye contact, six contact. Eye contact, ear contact, nose contact, tongue contact, body contact, and mind contact. These are the six contact. Nobody can repute. Have to accept. That is what is truth. Nothing to believe. Nothing to cling to. Then Buddha said, there are 18 bases, mental proliferations, 18 places where we are observing, we are doing our own examinations. What are the 18 places? Through the eye there are three. When we have three types of feelings, when we see something, we feel. When we feel, there are three types of feeling. Pleasant feeling, unpleasant feeling and neutral feeling. These are the three types of feeling where we are doing our own explorations, mental proliferations as well. So, through eye there are three, the ear three, nose three, tongue three, body three and mind three. Three multiplied six, 18. 18 places. These are the Dhamma the Buddha taught. Buddha said, these are the Dhamma. And then Buddha said, the special Dhamma, central teaching of the Buddha. What is the central teaching of the Buddha? The Four Noble Truths. Nothing but the Four Noble Truths. When we say about Four Noble Truths, when we talk about Four Noble Truths, sometimes people might think there are four truths in the world. Friends, no four truths in the world. There's only one truth in the world. Should be one. Otherwise, how people can understand. if there are many truths. How people can understand this? No such truth, many truths, only one truth in the world. What is that truth? That truth should be common to the world, common to all beings, not only humans. That should be common to all beings. What is that truth? That is unsatisfactoriness. Wherever beings, there is unsatisfactoriness. Dukkha. The Buddha used the term dukkha. Dukkha is all over the world. Wherever beings, they have dukkha, unsatisfactoriness. Then the Buddha understood that there is a cause of dukkha. Then there is a cessation of dukkha, for which there is a path to be developed. That is the path leading to the cessation of dukkha. So these are the four facets of dukkha, not four truths, but four facets of truth. That is, friend, that is how we should understand these four noble truths, four facets of truth. So the Buddha realized these four noble truths, which we call four noble truths. Why they are called noble? Because the noblest one, the Buddha, rediscovered this. Even before this Buddha, there were many Buddhas in the past. They themselves had the same four noble truths. That is why we use the term rediscovered. It's a rediscovery. Buddha realized this, rediscovered this, and revealed this Dhamma. The four noble truths. Once a certain Brahmin named Brahmayu came to see the Buddha. He understood the Buddha's qualities and the characteristics of his body, seen them all. He was so glad, so delighted seeing the Buddha, and then he felt at the, he fell at the feet of the Buddha and respected the Buddha. Thereafter, the Buddha said, referring to him, the Buddha said, abhinyayang abhinyatang bhave tabbancha bhavitang pahatabbang pahinang me tamahang buddhosmi brahmana. Buddha introduced him as the Buddha. Buddha said, abhinyayang abhinyatang, what is to be comprehended, I comprehended it. What is to be comprehended? There is something to be comprehended. I comprehended it. Abhinyayang abhinyatang. Bhave tabbancha bhavitang, there is something to be developed, I developed it. Bhave tabbancha bhavitang. Paha tabbang pahinang me, there is something to be abandoned, I abandoned it. Paha tabbang pahinang me, tamahang buddhosmi brahmana, therefore, Brahmin, I am called Buddha, I am the Buddha, he said. What is to be comprehended? Dukkha is to be comprehended. Unsatisfactoriness is to be comprehended, to be understood. Dukkha is to be understood as dukkha, as it is. Then, bhave tabbancha bhavitam, there is something to be developed. What is to be developed? The Noble Eightfold Path is to be developed. So the Buddha said, I developed it. Then what is to be abandoned? The craving is to be abandoned. Craving is the cause for dukkha. It is to be abandoned. So the Buddha did this. Therefore Buddha said, Therefore, I am the Buddha. Friends, this is how the Buddha taught this wonderful Dhamma. This unparalleled Dhamma, unparalleled Dhamma. This wonderful Dhamma. In order to realize this Dhamma, he, the Buddha, gave us the technique of meditation. That technique is again unique technique. That is based on samatha vipassana. It is samatha and vipassana both. In order to practice samatha, you know, even before the Buddha, there were many who practiced samatha meditation. But Buddha's samatha samadhi is different. Buddha's samadhi meditation is called noble right concentration. Noble right concentration. It is supported by seven factors, which is again unique, unparalleled, in parallel. That Dhamma, the concentration with the support of the first seven factors of the Noble Eightfold Path, which is called noble right concentration. When we practice, develop this particular concentration, we can switch our meditation to insight, which is called vipassana, insight. So in order to practice vipassana, we have to practice this together. Samatha vipassana together, should go together, hand in hand, as tandem. That is the technique taught by the Buddha. That technique is given in the Mahasatipatthana Sutta. That is the sutta to be studied and understood this and practiced accordingly, according to the Mahasatipatthana Sutta. Every person, every Buddhist should read this sutta and follow that technique of the Buddha as the meditation technique. Not many different methods. Many different methods lead into many different destinations. This is why, friends, we have to follow the Buddha. Buddha is our teacher. Buddha has never appointed any teachers, any sort of techniques. Only this technique, Satipatthana meditation technique, where we practice samatha vipassana together in tandem. Then we can realize this Dhamma. In order to explain this, the Buddha gave Satipatthana Sutta, where the Buddha pointed out to establish the way to establish sati, mindfulness, which is the uniqueness in this teaching. It's the watchword. Key word is mindfulness. It's like the nucleus of the triangle. Sati, mindfulness. So the Buddha taught us to establish mindfulness on four different places. What are the four places? Establish mindfulness on your body, kaya, kai, kayanu passe viharati. Secondly, said, establish mindfulness on your feeling, vedanasu, vedananu passe viharati. Third, establish mindfulness on your mind, chitte, chittanu passe viharati. Fourth, establish mindfulness on mental objects, dhammesu, dhammanu passe viharati. In such a way, Buddha taught us the four establishments of mindfulness. Then he taught us how to practice. First, when you practice, you have to maintain four factors. What are the four factors? You should have effort. First thing is effort to practice, effort to continue your meditation. Atapi. Secondly, sampajano, understand it clearly, understand your object clearly. Sampajano. Third, satyama, mindfully, practice mindfully, given full attention, be alert, with earnestness, practice with earnestness, practice diligently, diligently, vigilantly, be in wise practice, continuously, persistently, practice, practice. Satyama, vinaya loke abhijja domanasan, give up both abhijja and domanasa. Abhijja is covetousness, domanasa is grief. Avoid both and practice equanimously. So ardently, clearly comprehending, mindfully and equanimously practice your meditation. Continue your meditation. This is the teaching of the Buddha. Then the Buddha taught us to find a suitable place, congenial place, and then observe this breath. Breath is another kaya, another body. We have two bodies, this body and the breath body. So the Buddha asked to observe, first observe this body, breath body, then this corporeality. In such a way, six different methods, objects were given to observe this body. Six different sections are there in the sutta. And then the Buddha taught us to understand different nature of this feeling. Thereafter, understand the mind as mind, according to the nature of mind. Finally, we can realize the Dhamma. When we realize this Dhamma, we can understand our own hindrances and completely cut off hindrances. Then we can understand the five aggregates, 12 bases. Then we can further develop seven factors of enlightenment and finally come to the path, and we come to the end of the path, completing the path to 10 factors. The path, not the noble eightfold path, but noble tenfold path. The path becomes tenfold path, with that one attain enlightenment, as a supreme enlightenment, as an arahant. This is the path which is very clear. This is a unique path, tenfold path. Without noble right concentration, nobody can come to the ninth factor of the path. Factor of the path is the true knowledge, right knowledge. That is nothing but the knowledge of the four noble truths. Without ninth factor, nobody can come to the tenth factor, which is the right liberation. Right liberation. Why right liberation? Because there is wrong liberation as well. So we have to come to right liberation. When we come to right liberation, the liberated one can understand clearly that since then, no birth. Birth is destroyed. Khina jati. He himself, she herself can say that. Khina jati, destroyed future birth. Khina jati. Vushitam brahmacharyam led the holy life, Katang karaniyan, done what had to be done. Na parang ittathayati, there's nothing to be done any longer. Never come again. This is the expression. With that, he or she becomes an akina servant, the arahant. His or her mind is the liberated mind. When it is liberated, one says it is liberated. Vimuktasming, vimuktamiti jnanam hoti, she herself can realize that it is liberated. What is liberated? Mind is liberated. From what? From all taints. Taint free. Kina asavat. That is the mentality, that is the consciousness, that is the vijnana, which is called anidassana vijnana. Why it is called anidassana vijnana? Anidassana means no feature. Featureless consciousness. Featureless means there is no feature, no feature like nama, rupa, patavi, apo, tejo, vayo, no earth, water, fire, air, no physicality, no mentality, like that. No such thing. That is why it is called featureless consciousness, anidassana vijnana, which is infinite, anantam, sabbato pabham, it is bright, luminous, all over. Such is the mind. That is the mental, that is the consciousness of the arahant, which has no way, no place to cling to. No place to cling to means no re-becoming, no birth. Birth is destroyed. Friends, that is the teaching. That is the way. Those who have such mentality, such consciousness, are still living here. In this society, peacefully, unattached, that is the difference. So this is how the Buddha taught us this wonderful Dhamma, this marvelous Dhamma, this unique Dhamma. Therefore, let's all understand this wonderful Dhamma, unique Dhamma. And let's understand the uniqueness of the Buddha and this Dhamma. And let's learn this Dhamma. Let's practice this Dhamma so that we can live happily, peacefully in this world. And one day we can realize real peace, real happiness of Nibbana. May we all attain supreme bliss, real bliss of Nibbana. Sadhu, sadhu, sadhu. Q&A. If you have any question, you can ask. I know only two subjects, Dhamma and meditation. Please ask question only on these two subjects. Don't ask any question on any other subjects. I am a bhikkhu. I am a disciple of the Buddha. I know only these two subjects. I don't worry about other subjects, and I don't talk about other subjects.
I've heard that there's dependent ordination, the Buddha explains,
Something along the lines of, I can't remember what the exact saying was. It goes dukkha domana supayasa jara marnam, you know, it goes like that. And could you explain those things, Bhante? Give a bit of explanation between dukkha, dhamma, upayasa and parideva. Especially upayasa, I don't have the best understanding. And also, can you differentiate between these things, or explain similarities between that and kalakirna? I don't know what the English word is. Perhaps disenchantment. Could you talk of the similarities and the differences between those terms? Thank you.
Dukkha domanasa upayasa. What are the two terms? Upayasa?
Dukkha domanasa upayasa parideva.
Upayasa parideva. Are these the two terms that you need to know?
If you could differentiate between upayasa parideva and also the kalakirina.
Mm. Upayasa means, upa means internal, inside. Ayasa means you make effort inside. That means to express your sort of urgency, your feeling that is not happy feeling. When you have some sort of feeling like anger, you need to cry, but you don't cry. Inside you are crying. Upayas, you take effort, you make effort to cry inside. That is called upayasa. Ayasa means effort, you make effort. Upa means inside. So effort, like this, you try to cry, but don't cry. Right? That is why that is called upayasa. Then upayasa parideva. Parideva is lamenting. You lament, you say something loudly, saying and cry. That's lamenting. What is the other word? Kalakirima. Kalakirima is like in Sinhalese people think that kalakirima means quite disgusted. Disgusted, that is not kalakirima. Disgusted, when you disgust, you keep hands like this and you are quite contemplative, you are thinking what to do, this, what to do like that. That is what is kalakirima, which is not the kalakirima, real kalakirima in the teaching of the Buddha. Kalakirima in this context means you are quite disenchanted. Disenchantment is the term in English. So disenchant means you are not satisfied with that. You see that it is useless. It's meaningless. What is the meaning? It's meaningless. You are doing something but meaningless. Useless. You see the uselessness of that thing. And with that you are turning away. You are turning away because it's useless. That is what is called kalakirima. Okay?
Thanks, Bhante.
Bhante, you said that...
2% here. It's okay. Let him do. Okay, go ahead.
You said that the Buddha rediscovered the Four Noble Truths. I thought that was unique for the Buddha. Can you just explain that? What does that mean, that the Four Noble Truths was already around before the Buddha rediscovered it?
Yeah, before that means it is there all over the world every time, but it is hidden. With the absence of the Buddha, it is the Buddha who rediscovered this. Four Noble Truths are there in the world. Every dukkha is every day, right? Everywhere. Even animals, they have dukkha. But they don't know what dukkha is. When the Buddhas are born, they reveal this. They rediscovered dukkha as the fact. As a fact, they take this as a fact and then they see that it is because of craving, dukkha arises. Now, of course, we know this, but in the absence of the Buddha, we never know this. So only Buddhas rediscover the Four Noble Truths.
And you also spoke about three existence. You must have touched on it, but I missed it. Could you just...
What is that?
The three forms of existence, you said.
Three?
Forms of existence. Existence.
Three forms?
You touched on that, did you, Bhante?
Three characteristics of existence.
Three, not three forms. Three characteristics are anicca, dukkha and anatta. These are the characteristics of all things, animate or inanimate. All things have this mark, three marks. These are called three characteristics.
Thank you, Bhante.
Here.
Bhante, on the last part of your talk, you mentioned that birth was destroyed and no more rebirth. Mind was liberated. And can I then say that I can have faith that Buddha still exists, even though all arahants that pass away still exist, because they don't attach to the body for rebirth?
Sorry, I couldn't get
it. So, on the last part of the talk, Bhante mentioned that birth was destroyed and... no more rebirth attached to the birth, to the body for rebirth.
Yeah.
Mind was liberated.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. This is how the arahant or those who are enlightened.
Yeah.
And can I then say that this mind that was liberated still exists?
Mind is liberated then?
Yeah. They still exist in this.
Exist
in this universe. And but they don't attach to the body to any forms.
Where does it exist? Where should it exist, the mind, if it is existing? Can the mind then exist? Is there anything isolatedly existing in the world? Anything isolatedly existing in the world? Can you tell me anything isolatedly exists in the world?
Maybe those formless...
Home?
Formless.
Formless what?
Beings or whatever.
No such beings. Formless beings are not available. All beings have forms. Not form like ours, but they themselves have forms, which are called subtle forms.
Alright, so can Bhante then explain again the last part Bhante was saying about birth destroyed, no more rebirth, no more attachment, mind liberated, they may still exist.
There is no place to exist, that is why it is called liberated. If something is liberated from one thing and unified with another, no liberation. Suppose you are liberated, you are released from the prison, and you are going home, and you are in your home like a prisoner, again a prison, like that. So liberated means your mind is liberated from what? Mind is liberated from all physicality. All physicality and mentality. Nama rupa. Liberated from nama rupa. That is what it means. Because as long as we are in sansara, there's a cycle. That is called sansaric cycle. This sansaric cycle is formed with nama rupa and vijnana. Nama rupa means mentality and physicality both. Where you find nine different factors. When you say nama, feeling, perception, volitional formation, contact and attention. These five are called nama, mentality. Then there are four things, physicality. Earth, water, fire, air. Altogether, nine factors. These nine factors, okay? That is one part of the cycle. Then vijnana, consciousness. That is the other part. So what happens when we practice, one day we have to break this cycle. Once you break the cycle, this physicality and mentality fall down. Then consciousness remains. Consciousness itself is supported with some sankhara. The sankhara also to be cut off. And then the sankhara is connected to ignorance. Ignorance itself is to be cut off. Ignorance is connected to taints. Taints are to be cut off. Taints are connected with ignorance. Once you cut off taints, you become taints free. Taints free means your mind is clear mind, no more taints, no more impurities. That purity, that mind is called luminous mind, featureless mind, that is in Pali, anidassana vijnana. That is the enlightened one's vijnana, which has no place to cling to, nowhere to cling to, because it is the only consciousness, which is again within, come to the cessation, not outside but within. When the arahants pass, it's within, it's come to cessation. That's the mentality, that is consciousness. That is the end of consciousness. Okay? Yes.
Saying that they have a temporary seeing or temporary kind of experience of nirvana, so they know that the end exists and there's absolute faith in that?
He experiences the nirvana?
A temporary experience of clear mind, a luminous mind that is temporarily free of the kilesas, the taints, is that? Correct.
Yeah, that's the stream enterer can experience nibbanic bliss.
Yeah,
that is what that is how it is said. Like, because you yourself can understand that from this day you will not be born in animal realm, not born in woeful states like hells. Or you are not be born again in the realm of hungry ghost, then it is clear that you are stream enterer. From that day you will definitely, that is how it is said in the suttas, definitely, certainly you will lead to the attainment of enlightenment. That means you can understand that your destiny is crystal clear. The destiny is the Nibbana. Nibbana is clear. You know that. Okay?
Yeah, thank you.
The question of temporary realization of Nibbana, temporary. Have you got to be a stream mentor to do that, or can the person...
What is that temporary realization?
A state of selflessness. In suttas they talk about...
What is that?
Non-self. A feeling of non-self.
Feeling
of non-self. There is no self.
Yeah.
I mean, we do. I mean, suttas, Buddha discusses about temporary states of nibbana.
Can you give me the Pali term for that?
In Anguttarikaya, there are places like that.
No such thing. No temporary nibbana.
No, I mean momentary realization of non-self. No. Okay.
No such thing in the teachings. Show me, if you show me the sutta, I can accept it. I have never come across this. No temporary nibbana.
No, it's not. It's a momentary...
Momentary consciousness, yeah. You can say momentary consciousness, but it is even from the commentaries, not from the suttas. Those are not from the original teachings. Shanika Samadhi, that is what is the term. Shanika Samadhi is the contemporary concentration. Sorry, not contemporary, temporary. temporary concentration is called Shanika Samadhi, which is not in the discourses.
There's this thing called, all I'd say this in Sinhalese because I don't know the Ashrava Sahita Samadhitya and Ashrava Rahita Samadhitya. It is said that Pratajana, people have Ashrava Sahita Samadhitya, for example, and those who are the noble ones, like stream entry above, have Ashrava Rahita. If you could, so I don't know whether that's what they are.
No, no, that is not temporary. That is not ashrava even. That is called asava. Not ashrava. This is asava. Asava, that is according to Mahachattarisaka Sutta. Mahachattarisaka means Great 40. Discourse name, there is a discourse name, Great 40. Where the Buddha explained this tenfold path as 40. Factors. The Buddha pointed out two types of path, the normal path and supernormal path. When you come to normal path, where the Buddha says, Sasava Punyabhagya Upadi Vipaka. This is referring to taints of connected to the right understanding. When you have right understanding with worldly type of right understanding, you have right understanding to do good deeds, such as giving dana. You know that it is good. You are supporting parents. You know that they will be re-becoming next birth. You believe the previous birth, rebirth, like that. Those are called good.